December the 4th, Indian jets attack Dakar Airport for the first time. After a night bomb raid on Dakar, the search for the bodies in the wreckage of an orphanage. Estimates of the dead vary. 200, 400 and more. Nobody will ever know for sure. Most of the dead are children. Who can have been responsible for such a cowardly act? The Indians say it wasn't them, and the East Bengalis believe them. It was the Pakistani Air Force, they claim. The Pakistanis are doing this to make us hate the Indians, I was frequently told. It wasn't until the war was over that I learned the identity of the mysterious night bomber who was responsible for this. It was an Indian pilot who gave me a lift to Calcutta. After the bombs, the exodus from the city centre to safer places. But there's no panic. Many of these people have spent most of the past 9 months running away from somebody who wanted to kill them. They are fleeing too because they know the center of their city may become the battleground where the Pakistani army in the east will make its last stand. And they don't want to get caught in the crossfire. By now, the word from the battlefronts is that the Pakistani army is running critically short of ammunition, fuel and food, and it has no chance of being resupplied. We all suspect it's only a matter of time, days probably, before the Indians reach Dakar. The 9th of December, as the city empties, the Red Cross seeks agreement from the war chiefs of Pakistan and India to make the Intercontinental Hotel a neutral zone. As such, it's first of all a sanctuary for hundreds of foreign nationals awaiting evacuation. But later, the hotel is to become the place where much of the war's drama is enacted. The war is 5 days old.
Promise.
Okay.
Because you've got to come every day.
What? They're not coming every day, these two.
All right. No, you say no.
No, they can't, because otherwise everybody will be coming for
all
breakfast
right.
For 10 minutes.
Thank you.
Reporters and cameramen take it in turn to keep a round-the-clock guard on the hotel gate. The Geneva Convention, which lays down the ground rules for neutrality, states, among other things, that no arms must be allowed in. And, empowered by the Red Cross, it's our job to see that no weapons do get through. By evening, there are high hopes that evacuation planes will arrive tomorrow. It's 10:30 now on Saturday the 11th of December. We're at Dakar Airport waiting for the British evacuees to come out. And just as we arrive, there's an air raid warning on. And we ask ourselves, could it be that these are the British planes coming in to pick up our people and there's been no message through to the airport? Or is it an Indian raid? We just don't know. By now, as the war closes in around us, the foreign nationals awaiting evacuation are desperate and frightened. Several previous attempts to evacuate them have been thwarted by Indian bombs, direct hits on the runway at Dakar Airport.
Please return to the Intercon Hotel.
Why is it cancelled?
General, a general in command, whoever it is, around the area, military man.
Yes.
Return to the Intercon. The evacuation has been stopped by the military.
Why? Do we know?
Don't know.
The whole evacuation?
At this stage, yes.
Everybody, women and children.
Everybody.
Don't hold up the whole convoy.
They're just
there.
In the muddle and confusion, nerves are becoming raw and tempers frayed. Quite suddenly, the Pakistani commander, General Niazi, turns up.
Good morning, how are you?
Morning, sir. Someone says the evacuation's cancelled.
I'm Ronald Robson. You were looking for me yesterday.
Yes. How are you?
Very well, sir.
I'm glad to see you.
Hello.
How
are you?
Who spread the rumor that I have run away?
You are the man. As usual, the general is eager to chat to reporters.
If you ask it was the Brahman Broadcasting Corporation, BBC.
We're spreading your rumors.
I can tell you one thing, man. I'm the man I'll take the tank over my body. You'll see my dead body and alive.
General, you remember me, Arthur Paul.
I remember you very well.
Indeed. We have arranged our evacuation today. We have full clearances from your government in Islamabad. We are now told on arrival at the airport, the general command has said that the evacuation cannot take place. We must ask for clarification and assistance in this matter.
Ask
the aircraft, as far as we know, are in the sky on their way here.
Ask Islamabad, ask the governor. I am the military commander. Governor doesn't come under me. President tells him it's incorrect.
Well, everything having been arranged. Everything having been arranged, I think we must proceed on the basis that the evacuation is to take place.
There is a system of government in every country.
How close would you say they are to Dhaka now, General?
Why should I tell you?
They say they're going to be here very early next week, General.
Let them be. I'm ready. Quicker the better. Why don't they come?
Well, we think they are coming, quite honestly.
Well, let them come. I say you go with them. You will take very good pictures.
You think you can take care of them?
Care of who?
The Indians.
My goodness. Anybody else also with them? Not only Indians.
You look after us, General.
Inshallah. Come to me anytime. At your service, gentlemen. Anytime.
As the foreign nationals return once more in despair to the hotel, anxious questions. Some wonder if they're now being held as hostages. The next day, the first of the RAF Hercules lands between the bomb craters on a stretch of runway we had cleared of the debris after the previous night's raids. The first of the 400 or so foreign nationals to be hustled aboard the rescue plane are women and children. We did all we could to speed up the evacuation because we were all sharing the same unspoken fear. 3 days before, women and children awaiting evacuation at the airport had had to dive into trenches when Indian jets attacked. Could it happen again? There is a race against the clock, too. It had taken us so long to clear the runway of rubble with our bare hands that the time agreed for the truce is ticking away faster than anyone expected. As the giant Hercules lumbers down the runway for takeoff, some of us pray. It only just made it getting down empty, and now it has a full load on. Well, the third and last evacuation plane is about to leave, but we're not going to stay right here on the strip to see it go because there's only 20 minutes of the extended truce time left, and we expect, wouldn't be surprised, if the moment the truce is over, Indian jets are overhead knocking the hell out of this airstrip. Also, we're about to witness, as we withdraw to the centre of Dhaka, the last stand by the Pakistanis in the east, we think. We expect that the real fight for Dhaka is about to unfold. The next day, Monday the 13th, and for no apparent reason, General Niazi, the tiger, appears on a street corner.
General, I'm afraid I arrived late on that.
You are always late, son. Why? You are the youngest. You should be the furthermost.
Yeah, well, I've got this belly, you see.
Not bigger than mine.
What do you see happening when the Indians do hit town, General?
Well, I told you, we'll fight it out.
Is there a real possibility of street-by-street fighting?
Inshallah, we'll keep them away.
The feeling is that you don't have enough men here in the town to put up a big fight.
Makes no difference. I never show my men.
Will you make any attempt at a conditional surrender?
No, sir. The question is either we live or we die.
As usual on these occasions, we got no useful information from the general. But then again, that's not the purpose of a publicity stunt. Perhaps it is because they are so well hidden that we never ever see more than a handful of General Niazi's men, even on our brief probes towards the front line, only 8 miles away on one sector. But more likely, or so it seems to us, the general is bluffing when he claims he has enough men to defend the city. At this stage, we are still getting no real information about the progress of the war. So we seize every opportunity to talk to military personnel. On this occasion, a Pakistani army doctor.
What have been the extent of casualties by the Pakistan army?
Well, we have a total, I think, in this, in the Dhaka sector alone. But don't forget that these casualties have come from other sectors.
But do you have many casualties?
Oh,
are there many?
Oh, yes. In fact, that's the reason why we keep on going back and forth and contacting the Red Cross, is that we have a lot more casualties than we can do with.
Could you give us an estimate of the number?
I think about 1,000.
Father, you come to us from the other side of the town. What's the news from your side?
Well, there was considerable firing last night. From 10 until 11 o'clock, there was a lot of machine gunning, Sten guns, single rifle shots. And then again in the morning, at about 4 to 4:30, there was heavy firing.
And who was doing the firing?
We heard this morning that the governor's house had been attacked. There are machine gun emplacements along the walls, and it's quite possible that the Mufti Bahini were attacking the governor's house. Since the Razakars do not have any automatic weapons, it was either Army or Mukti Bahini or both who were firing the automatic weapons.
That's a bad sign, because that would imply that the Mukti want to do everybody in government house, which would be General Farman, the governor, and the chief secretary.
Now that's a likely surmise.
The early morning shooting around government house leads to the swift exodus of ministers and senior civil servants of President Yahya's puppet government who were holed up there. And they're allowed to enter the protection of the neutralized hotel on condition that they don't bring any weapons.
Where did this come from? You've just taken that out of a bag, have you?
Yes, it was sitting here, nobody would claim it.
You did ask, did you, and nobody would claim it. Whose briefcase is this?
Come on, let's find who brought it.
Whose briefcase is this? The Inspector General of Police is not here. It could be his.
Is there anything inside?
Keep silent. If we have somebody not giving back now all the pistols and the war material, we'll put out. We'll send out.
So there is a very blunt warning from the Red Cross to all of the government house people who have come here. If they won't surrender their weapons or they won't play the game by the right rules, then they're out. By the early afternoon of Tuesday, the 14th of December, Government House is burning. It's taken several direct hits and a rocket attack by Indian jets. But on close, though quick, inspection, the damage does not appear to be great.
There were lots of rockets, but how many big bombs?
We didn't get any.
We didn't get any.
And was this the only target area, this part of the building, or was there more?
More. I think more.
They shot us along there. There was cannon fire from the plane, was there? Cannon?
Yeah.
They also fired bullets.
Bullets.
Has anybody been killed?
No.
The governor, Mr. Malik, was here at the time.
I can't say. We belong to civil defense, you see?
Fine.
We belong to civil defense. We have come at the request of
Divisional warden.
Yeah. Yes, but you don't have any guns to defend yourself with.
No, sir.
After a second airstrike, the last man to flee from Government House to the protection of the hotel is Governor Malik. His arrival means that the civilian administration of East Pakistan has collapsed.
What's the position, Governor? Have you resigned?
Observer correspondent Gavin Young was at Government House with Malik during the attacks. Gavin, how near was the governor to resigning before the first airstrike?
Well, he seemed to be completely undecided. He was there with his ministers in the bunker by this time, with his wife and grown-up daughter in the room next door in the same bunker. And he was still seemed to be debating it. He was asking things like, how could he get his wife and daughter out of the governor's house, which was being demolished around him, to the Intercontinental Hotel. And John Kelly of the United Nations was telling him it would probably be arranged, but he couldn't arrange it himself because the UN doesn't want to get mixed up in all that kind of thing.
But was it, as far as you know, the airstrike that actually did convince him to resign?
Well, it looked very much like it, because everybody was discussing all this about his wife. Suddenly the second strike came in, second raid began. There was an almighty crash. And it seemed as though between the first crash, in a matter of seconds, some of his ministers had whipped out ballpoint pens, had produced bits of carbon and little bits of paper, and had written a resignation statement in 10 seconds flat. Not only resignation, resigning, but more than that, quite interesting, disassociating himself from any future action the government might take, central government.
Worried about what President Yahya Khan might think?
I don't think at that point he was worrying about anything else but getting out of the bunker, away from the raids, and terminating any responsibility for what might happen.
How did he carry himself?
Incidentally, he'd written out the statement, the second bomb fell.
To confirm in his judgment, as it were.
Exactly, yes. He then opened a little door to a washroom and took off his shoes and socks, hiked his leg up into the basin, turned the water on, of course, washed his feet very carefully and meticulously. All hell breaking loose outside, by the way. Put a handkerchief over his head, went down and prayed in the corner of the bunker.
Another arrival at the hotel, Mr. Popov, the Russian consul. The Geneva Convention says no diplomats.
At least be diplomatic.
Don't be uncivilized.
At least be diplomatic.
Could we, Lord, please.
I'm sorry, sir. Could we, before you enter?
You can't go in. We have to do a search.
Please,
I'm sorry. We have to do a search.
Please, sir. My name.
We don't care who you are.
But Mr. Popov is not to be deterred.
He will not register, and he's trying to force his way into the hotel. The Red Cross man has asked him to register and he refuses to do so.
He seemed to be very drunk to me.
He is drunk. He's drunk and abusive. And I want him out of the hotel.
Well, the war is nearly over in East Pakistan now, which is about to become Bangladesh. And we think the purpose of the jets coming over now is really to say to the PAK army, you might as well surrender, those of you that haven't, because it really is just about all over. So we think the Indian pilots are beating it up really for the hell of it now. As the Indians step up their pressure, the panic increases, and the hotel welcomes more refugees.
Coming out.
Colonel, is there any question of a surrender yet, do you know? Would you know?
No, surrenders.
Yeah. There's no question of it. You know for sure, no question.
No question of any surrender.
That what General Niazi has been saying still stands.
He means
fight to the last man.
He means it.
And you mean it with him or all,
of course,
all of you behind
everyone.
Him?
Everyone.
The purpose of this Indian attack now is that they've located General Niazi's new headquarters. We think General Niazi, the commander of the what's left of the Pakistan Army here, has shifted his headquarters. We believe the Indians know about it. And we think they're now trying to kill Niazi, to strike directly at his new headquarters.
Wednesday, the war is 12 days old.
General, could you give us a quick rundown of how you view the situation at this time?
Well, actually, as I told you, I'm not in command of the troops. The troops are being commanded by General Niazi, and he's the right person to tell you what the situation is.
But General Farman, if you were in control, would you not now think of surrendering? Isn't it ludicrous to go on?
No, why should we surrender?
Well, it's now 10:20 on Wednesday the 15th, and the news that has just reached me is that Yahya Khan has given the order to surrender in the east. In fact, he gave his agreement to this at 4 o'clock yesterday afternoon. And what is about to happen now is that General Farman Ali, who was military advisor to the civilian government, is coming here to talk to the ex-members of the government about the surrender deal. He will leave here then to go and see General Niazi, and he will ask General Niazi to obey President Yahya Khan. We assume he will, but we're not quite sure about it. But that's about what's going to happen now.
We are facing a very important moment now, and it's so important to have all this at this stage all over the world in the television cameras. So I please ask you kindly, for the first time, you have been very cooperative so far, to go back in the hotel, and there will be no television filming or any kind this time. I will try to arrange something later on. Thank you.
This is a fairly historic moment, and we would like to have some formal recording of the fact that these people came in. You might put it to them, but I think we should have some record of this.
Let's get organized.
Incredibly, the hotel is now the center of the drama. These latest attacks by the Indian Air Force seem to be, since everybody else has agreed to surrender but General Niazi. These are just a message, in fact, to General Niazi to say, you better sign on the dotted line too. I think that's what it's about now. Well, these people don't seem to have got the message, but they hardly could have done yet. But if they're not careful, they'll find themselves the first candidates for the Mukti guerrillas, because these are people foolishly outside the hotel shouting, "Long live East Pakistan," and that's not the sensible thing to do at the moment.
General Farman will come in at 11:30, and would we be extremely discreet and stand back, because General Niazi should have been here but refuses to come because of the press. In other words, our presence here and so on may or may not affect people's lives.
General Farman arrives on schedule. His position is difficult. Privately, he's been urging a surrender for days. The situation at 2:05 on Wednesday the 15th is that we now know that General Niazi has accepted the principle of a ceasefire, but negotiations are getting pretty well bogged down at the moment. What Niazi seems to be looking for is a face-saving formula. He doesn't want the word surrender used. By mid-afternoon, the Indian jets are overdoing it, and their rockets are hitting civilian targets. If General Niazi decides, after all, to fight to the finish, he could force the Indians to destroy much more of the city. Well, at 4:20, the latest position is that General Niazi has accepted a conditional ceasefire. What I mean is that he has transmitted to his president, Yahya Khan, that he is prepared to accept a ceasefire, but on conditions. And those conditions are thought to imply that the soldiers in East Pakistan will keep their arms. In any event, these terms are now to be offered to the Indians, and we wait to see what happens from then on. At dawn on Thursday, the fighting is continuing. Hopes for a ceasefire dim, and then...
We thought it best to call you together in order to give you the facts of what happened this morning. As you know, India gave an ultimatum to the Pakistan forces in East Pakistan to surrender by 9:30 this morning. In discussion with the military liaison officer attached to the Intercontinental, we found that there had been a breakdown of communications on the Pakistan Army network, which had been destroyed during the fighting. We also found it impossible, he found it rather impossible, to contact military headquarters by telephone. We were therefore unable to know whether A, the ultimatum had been accepted, and B, whether, if it had been accepted, that acceptance had been transmitted to the Indian authorities. Accordingly, in view of the extreme urgency of the matter and the likelihood of an immediate and severe attack on the city, Colonel Lampel of the Red Cross, Colonel Gafur, the Pakistan liaison officer, and myself went to the cantonment about 9 o'clock. We there met with General Farman, who confirmed that the communications network had been destroyed. He asked me, on behalf of the United Nations, if we would transmit a message to New Delhi. That message was that the ultimatum was accepted.
Minutes after the surrender, we find the first proof that Pakistani army collaborators have been indulging in a last orgy of killing. As we all discovered later, as many as 200 East Bengalis, potential leaders of the new nation, had been dragged from their homes and butchered. As news of the Pakistani army's surrender spreads, the Mukti Bahini guerrillas come from their hiding places in the city. Not long before, some of them and their supporters had been guests and waiters in the hotel. Their first target is the radio station just down the road from the hotel. Some of them want to shoot their way in, despite the fact that there's no resistance. But for the moment, a semblance of Mukti Bahini law and order prevails. Unofficially, the birth of the new nation is proclaimed when the Bangladesh flag is raised over the radio station. But then, panic. Pakistani soldiers, it said, are firing into the mob. The shots, in fact, came from the guns of other Mukti guerrillas who were firing salutes into the air. In the midst of all this confusion, the Indians finally arrived. Welcome to Dhaka. Looking at the scene from this end, it has seemed like a rout of the Pakistan army. Is that a fair assessment of what's it been like?
I wouldn't say that. I think it's very heavy and hard fighting. But I think we went about as planned, I would say. Things worked out as we'd assessed it, more or less.
Were there moments where they did really put up a fight to the death?
Oh, yes. I think practically everywhere. The Pakistani soldiers fought extremely well, I must say. In fact, I would say at times it was so fanatical that I've sort of said, look at this man, he's just dying for something when he has no business to be, just come charging across. It's just ridiculous at times. I felt very sorry, in fact.
It seemed to us that you've taken your time. We've been expecting you for days, 4 or 5 days.
Yes.
What was holding you up particularly? Was it just the politics of the situation, or was it the fighting?
Well, I mean, we were not in a particular hurry, really. I mean, in the sense, we wanted to finish this as quickly as possible, but you know how it is. I mean, you don't want to lose too many men in the bargain. I mean, I like to save my men and yet win a battle if possible, rather than have them massacred. Because, I mean, this morning I lost 3 of my men. And this happened half an hour before the ceasefire or whatever it was.
If the Hindu Indians are surprised by the frenzied warmth of their reception, they don't show it. Only those of us who are detached from the scene have time enough to imagine the Muslim founders of Pakistan turning in their graves. But what about the guerrilla leaders? Can they restrain their supporters from revenge? Seconds later, the Mukti Bahini leaders watch while the mob beats up a suspected Pakistani collaborator. At midday, while final arrangements are being made for the formal surrender ceremony, I went to the Pakistani army headquarters. The new man in charge is General Jacobs, the Indian chief of staff for the Eastern Sector. For a victor, he is surprisingly depressed. Privately, he has always been opposed to the war. Now he tells me, I'm worried about the future. We have won the war, but I don't know if we can win the peace. Over lunch, the defeated General Niazi is equally frank. He confirms what we think we already know, that he kept fighting long after the war was lost because President Yahya tricked him into believing the Americans and the Chinese were going to join the fight to save East Pakistan from collapsing. When I suggested to General Niazi that he made a major tactical blunder in defending the prestige border towns instead of withdrawing to a defensive area around Dhaka, he says, yes, I know all that, and so did my commanders. We argued for a different strategy, but we had our orders, and we obeyed them because we are soldiers. At dusk, Indian paratroops arrived for the formal surrender ceremony on Dhaka racetrack.
A damn good run, huh? You had right through. It is expected of a paratrooper, yes. And you've done it.
Yeah, I know. Well, nice seeing you.
Hello. Good afternoon, sir. How are you?
What are you doing here?
Congratulations. Well, I thought I was doing these things for 8 months.
Well done. I've only done it for 8 days.
On reflection, would you say that the truth is that you really didn't have a chance from the very beginning of the war, once there was a war started?
I am not willing to give any interview, please.
Sir, you are at liberty.
Honestly,
not to say anything.
See, no.
I mean, that's...
I can talk
please,
to you...
Just a second, a little later. At the moment, some ceremony is to go on.
By now, General Niazi cannot hide the humiliation he so deeply feels. It seems to me that he is close to tears. And suddenly, we all feel desperately sorry for the once blustering general. At this moment, I think most of us would have given almost anything to see Yahya Khan in General Niazi's place. The change of ownership of one of the most populated and poorest parts of the world is now being confirmed. What the defeated Pakistani army leaves behind it is a legacy of bitterness and hatred. After all that's happened, it's not unnatural, I suppose, for the people of Bangladesh to bay for blood. Their soil is soaked with it. But the lust for revenge is a bad foundation for nationhood. For India now, the joys of victory. But the problems of bringing up a turbulent new nation are yet to come. In 1947, we, the British, carved up the subcontinent and created two separate states. Today, 24 years later, after a war that lasted only 13 days, there are now three states.